When the doctors told me that my husband wasn't going to live, I did something drastic. He was in a coma. I wasn't even really sure that he could hear me. And I said, honey, I know you're fighting really hard and you must be really tired, but if you want to live, please squeeze my hand and I will leave no stone unturned. And I waited and he squeezed my hand. So then I thought, oh my God, what am I going to do now? But I went home and I started doing research, and that's when I found phage therapy. Hi, I'm Stephanie Strathy. I'm the Associate Dean of Global Health Sciences at the University of California, San Diego, and I now co-direct the Center for Innovative Phage Applications and Therapeutics. My husband got sick in Egypt while we were traveling on vacation, and when it was realized that he was very ill, he was medevaced first to Germany because he was too sick to get home. And there they diagnosed him with a superbug. But in the 2 weeks it took for him to get stabilized and sent back home here to San Diego, his superbug acquired even more antibiotic resistance. It was now resistant to all antibiotics, even the last resort antibiotic, colistin. To be an infectious disease epidemiologist and to have your husband dying from a superbug, it felt like God's cruel joke. It's estimated that by the year 2050, 10 million people are going to be dying of superbug infections. That is one person every 3 seconds, every single year. A superbug is a bacterium that has evolved to have resistance against multiple antibiotics. The first superbug, MRSA, was discovered in 1961, and it rapidly spread around the world, and it was followed by many other types of superbugs. And you know, this problem isn't going away. Antibiotics are not working anymore, and there's hardly any new antibiotics in the pipeline. Phage is short for bacteriophage. Bacteriophages are viruses that have naturally evolved to attack bacteria. Phages are really an important part of our ecosystem, our bodies, our environment, the oceans. They're teeming with phage. They're about 100 times smaller than a bacterium. There's 10 million, trillion, trillion phages on the planet, and each one of them is uniquely positioned to attack specific bacteria and knock them out. So if I'm the bacterium, I might have a little receptor, and the phage comes along, and if it has a match for that bacterium, it attaches to that receptor and it drills in, and its genetic material is taking over the whole bacterial cell, and it turns it into a phage manufacturing plant. So it's not making bacteria anymore, it's making baby phages. Burst out of that bacterial cell, killing it, and then they go on to attack new bacteria until there's no bacteria it matches to anymore. Phages were actually discovered in 1917 by a French-Canadian, Félix de Harel. He used them to treat bacterial infections and even animal infections for the 1920s and 30s. They had quite a heyday. But when penicillin came on the scene around the time of World War II, phages were relegated to the back burner. So I found researchers that were studying phage, and I emailed them cold, and I said, I know that you get a lot of requests, but my husband is dying. Could you please help him? And lo and behold, total strangers said that they would. Researchers from, you know, Germany, Belgium, Switzerland, India, the Republic of Georgia, all offering phage. And luckily, we got phage in time to save him that matched his isolate. We injected the phages into his catheters, but because he was fully colonized with these bacteria, we also had to inject the phages into his bloodstream. They generally don't inject phages into the bloodstream because it could kill the person. 3 days after we started intravenous phage therapy, my husband, who was in a deep coma within hours of dying, lifted his head off the pillow and kissed his daughter's hand. Everybody in the ICU freaked out, myself included. Tom is doing great today. I mean, he has a few dings. He can't feel the bottoms of his feet, but he's doing really well. His case has been considered to be a breakthrough, and now we know that you can inject billions of phages into somebody's bloodstream and it doesn't cause any harm. In fact, it can be used to weed out the unfriendly bacteria and leaving the healthy ones behind. We get their bacterial isolate sent to us or our partner labs, and they look to see if they have any phages in their phage banks that will match or wipe out that particular bacteria. If they don't, we have to go to some crazy places to find those bacteria. Sewage, barnyards, dumps. Well, that's where you find your perfect predator. We take the sample from the environment and we put that sample on top of a petri dish that has the bacterial colonies on it. We incubate it for a couple of days, and if it comes back looking like Swiss cheese, then we know that that phage is in there gobbling up those bacteria. Mallory Smith was a CF patient who was having a double lung transplant. She had a superbug infection that was attacking her new lungs. We managed to find some phages, but we didn't get them to her in time to save her life. It was just devastating for me. I think about Mallory every single day. But we did learn something from her case. A little tiny microdose of phages had reached her lungs and had started to multiply. But one of the most miraculous cases was this case of a girl named Isabel who had cystic fibrosis, who'd had a double lung transplant, just like Mallory Smith did. And she was being attacked by this superbug. They were able to find phages that were sourced from a rotting eggplant in South Africa that matched Isabel's infection. So they used recombineering, which is a technique to edit the genomes of these phages, and they put it together in a phage cocktail. We convinced the doctors to intravenously treat her with phages. She left the hospital within a week. We're going to be beginning the first NIH-funded clinical trial this summer. If you're watching and you have a superbug infection or someone you know does, you can contact us at iPath to see if we can help. We realized that we were privileged because we had the connections and we had the resources to be able to find total strangers to step up to save my husband's life. And that most people dying from superbug infections don't have that luxury. That's why we decided to write our book, The Perfect Predator. We're fundraising right now to try to build an open source phage library that will have tens of thousands of phages that would be readily available to people, because we don't want this therapy to be forgotten for another 100 years.